Well, good morning, everyone. Thank you for being here. We're glad that you've joined us in our worshiping together this morning. Appreciate especially those who have joined us online, and love it when you guys are hugging each other and talking to each other. We love each other, don't we? And I appreciate so much you being here. We've had some great classes this morning, youth classes and teen classes and all our Bible classes. So grateful for those who have already this morning been laboring in the kingdom, and now you've come to worship. Appreciate you being here so much. And again, we want to thank those who are online. I want to read to you, this is Galatians 6 in verse 7 and following. Don't be deceived. God is not mocked, for whatever a man sows, this he will also reap. For the one who sows to his own flesh shall from the flesh reap corruption. The one who sows from the Spirit shall from the Spirit reap eternal life. And let us not lose heart in doing good, for in due time we shall reap if we do not grow weary. I know you know the law of the harvest, that whatever you plant, whatever you sow is what you're going to reap. Whatever you put into the ground is what's coming back to you. If you plant corn, you're going to get corn. If you plant green beans, you're going to get green beans. You know the law of the harvest. And the Bible here is using the law of the harvest in very much a spiritual way, that whatever we plant, if you send out love, you're going to get love back. You send out forgiveness, you plant forgiveness, you're going to get forgiveness back. Whatever it is that you put in is what you're going to get back. The law of the harvest is, it goes something like this, is that we always reap more than we sow. Isn't that right? You plant one seed and you get back plants that have sometimes thousands of seeds. You always get back more than you sow. And you normally get back, you reap later than you sow. You plant something and you may not see. A farmer doesn't plant something, go out the next day and expect to see this full growth. And so in your life is the same way. And I think the law of the harvest is such a powerful spiritual principle that it ought to be applied in everything in our life. And when we think about putting something into something, planting something, even this morning, I believe as we worship together, you will get out of our worship what you put into it. So many times people have said, well, I just didn't get much out of that class. I didn't get much out of that worship. It could be, and that is true in many occasions, but it could be, I think, how much did we put into it? How much did we invest into it? And so this morning, what I hope and I pray is that we will invest, we will plant in our worship this morning, knowing that we will get a return, that we will reap what we sow, and this morning we will sow in the right spirit, the right attitude, and the right things, whether it's our singing, whether it's our praying together, our reading of Scripture, or the preaching, that we will invest ourselves into these things, sow ourselves into these things, knowing that a great harvest can come in our life. Lord, thank you today for blessing us. We thank you for this beautiful day that you've given us, a day to truly worship you in spirit and in truth. We thank you for the songs of praise that we will lift and the prayers that will be lifted to you, the scripture, the Bible lesson, and all that's done as we meet around the table, Lord. So grateful to be with our brothers and sisters, to meet around the table and to reflect on what you did for us so long ago that we could not do for ourselves. Help us to invest this morning, to sow this morning, knowing that we will reap a great harvest. Thank you, Lord, for blessing us. Thank you for the good night's rest we've had, for being able to travel here this morning. For every small and large gift that we have, we know it comes from your hand. We thank you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Good morning, church. Will you stand for the first song?
To God be the glory, great things he hath done. So loved he the world that he gave us his Son, whom yield yet in need of grace, in need of love, in need of mercy raining down from high above, in need of strength, in need of peace, in need of things that only you can give to me. In need of Christ, the perfect love, my life you strong, great I am. This is my song, I am holy, I am your child, I am in need. In need of grace, in need of love, in need of mercy raining down from high above, in need of strength, in need of peace, in need of things that only you can give to me. In need of Christ, the perfect love, my life you strong, the great I am. This is my song, my melody, I am your child, I am in need.
Good morning.
I stand to praise you, but I fall to my knees. My spirit is willing, but my flesh is so weak. Light the fire in my soul, and the flame
When the trumpet of the Lord shall sound, and time shall be no more, and the morning breaks eternal bright and fair, when the sacred earth shall gather over on the other shore, and the ball is called and thunder, I'll be there. When the
good singing today. If you will open your Bible to the Gospel of Matthew in Matthew 6, I'm going to read those verses in just a minute. Last couple of weeks I've been talking about guarding our heart, and we started in the book of Proverbs in Proverbs chapter 4 and how important it is to guard our heart. In fact, the Bible says it's a priority. The Bible in Proverbs 4 and verse 23 says, guard your heart above all else. You know, the most important, the priority of your life ought to be the guarding of your heart, because it determines the course of your life. And so last week we looked at the words we say and what we say. We guard our hearts by guarding our mouth. In fact, Solomon goes on to say that in Proverbs 4 and verse 24, avoid all perverse talk, stay away from corrupt speech. And so we know that one of the ways we guard our hearts is by guarding our speech. And so I had a lesson last week on what it means to guard our mouths. Set a guard over our lips, the Bible says, as a prayer that that David prayed so long ago. And this morning I want to talk about guarding our eyes. Solomon again in Proverbs chapter 4 said, look straight ahead, fix your eyes on what lies before you. Our heart is connected with our eyes. What we see matters. What we look at really does matter, because it affects our hearts. And I think that's true for all of us. You know, any time I've noticed over the years that a television executive, you know, a producer, you know, filmmakers, that if they come under some kind of fire, criticism for what they're doing, they always say, hey, it doesn't matter. It doesn't really matter what your kids look at. You know, they say that in the school system. Hey, it really doesn't matter, this material, it's really not affecting your kids. I want you to remember this small illustration, okay? I hope you remember this, all right? Do you know what they paid for 30 seconds of commercial time during this last Super Bowl? For 30 seconds during the Super Bowl, they paid $7 million. Advertisers paid $7 million. So for 1 minute spot was $14 million. See how I did that? I doubled the time and doubled. It's got to be on you. Don't let anyone tell you that it doesn't matter what you look at. I want to tell y'all, why would corporations spend $14 million for a 30-second spot if what you looked at didn't matter? They know that what you look at, your heart will follow. They know that what you look at really does affect your life. And this is what Solomon is saying. It's what Jesus is going to say in the great Sermon on the Mount. It does matter what I watch. It does matter what I look at. And by the way, the positive side of that is, isn't that how you learn to do a lot of stuff? You watched your dad. You watched your mom. You know, it wasn't them telling you how to do it. You actually watched them how to do it, and then you had to do it yourself. When my sisters started to drive, my dad made them, with their car on the driveway of our house, he made them change a tire. He showed them how, and then they had to change it. Now, you got to remember, this was before cell phones. They couldn't call dad. You know, they couldn't call AAA. You know, they couldn't call Raymond Lee. And so my dad said, you know, at some point, you may be stranded somewhere and you're going to need to know how to change your tire, and I'm going to show you how. Today, people would say that's absolutely cruel. I want to tell you, my dad was a wise man. Because in order for them to learn something, he had to show them how. And I think one of them, my older sister, older of the two, both younger than I am, got stranded one time and was in the middle of nowhere and had to change a tire. We never did really ask her what she was doing out where she was, why she was stranded, but she was. And she had to change that tire. That's how we learn. You know, we show someone how to tie a shoe. We show someone how to button a shirt. It wasn't just talking to them, it was showing them. By the way, people are learning from you all the time. You don't ever say a word. You don't have to say a word, because they're watching your life. They're watching how you treat other people. They're watching how you handle stress in certain conditions and situations. And so you are always teaching visually by your life. You can't tell me that sitting down and watching 1 hour of trash on television isn't going to affect you. There are men, even some, I believe, in this congregation who have served in the military, served in the war, and what they saw has affected them. They've struggled with some of the visual things that they have seen on the battlefield because they had firsthand witnessed those things. There's an old saying that says our eyes are like the windows of the soul. Have you ever heard that? They're windows of the soul. There's a great verse that I think teaches that principle. It's in Gospel of Matthew, in Matthew chapter 6. I want to read it to you. Jesus said, don't lay up, this is verse 19, don't lay up for yourselves treasures on the earth where moth and rust destroy and where thieves break in and steal, but lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven where neither moth nor rust destroys, where thieves don't break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. The lamp of the body is the eye. Do you hear it? For therefore your eye is clear, your whole body will be full of light. But if your eye is bad, your whole body will be full of darkness. If therefore the light is in you is darkness, how great is that darkness? No one can serve two masters, for either he'll hate the one and love the other, or he'll hold the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and mammon. So you kind of see now in the context of what Jesus is teaching in the Sermon on the Mount, how it really does matter our eyes. Our eyes are a window, and what we see, we take into our heart. Now, I'm going to give you a couple illustrations. You know these. You already know these. In the very beginning in the book of Genesis, do you remember what happened to Eve? Satan tempts her. And the Bible says in Genesis chapter 3 and verse 6, when Eve saw the tree and it was good for food and it was a delight to the eyes, she took of its fruit and she ate it. So one of the first things Eve does is she looks on the fruit and she starts analyzing it. She starts thinking about it, looking at it. No different than Joshua chapter 7. One of my favorite stories in Joshua 7 is the story of Achan. Talk about coveting. When I try to explain to someone what it means to covet, Achan gives us a great description, a great definition of what it means to covet. Do you remember, they've just come off one of the great battles, the Battle of Jericho. And Israel has won this tremendous battle, and they go fight a small skirmish. And Israel gets beat. I mean, they're beat like a drum. And they're crying out, oh, what have we done? God, I thought you were on our side. And God said it's because there's sin in the camp. And a man by the name of Achan had decided to take some things, even though he was told that he shouldn't take anything under the ban. And he took those things. I want to read it to you. This is Joshua 7 in verse 21. Truly I have sinned, Achan said, against the Lord and the God of Israel, for this is what I did. I saw among the spoil a beautiful cloak of Shinar, 200 shekels of silver, a bar of gold weighing 50 shekels, and I coveted them, and I took them. See that they are hidden now in the earth inside of my tent with silver underneath. What Achan says is, this is what I did. I saw him. I saw those things. I coveted them. When you look at something and you start dwelling on it, your heart will follow. No greater illustration in all the Bible than David and Bathsheba, right? The Bible says that David should have been at war with other kings. Instead, he's at home. He gets off his couch, the Bible says, and he starts walking around on the rooftop of his house. And it says, it happened that one late afternoon, David arose from the couch and was walking on the roof of the king's house, and he saw from the roof a woman bathing, and the woman was very beautiful. And David sent and inquired of the woman, and someone said, is this not Bathsheba, the daughter of Eliam, the wife of Uriah the Hittite? From the very beginning, David knew that woman was. From the very beginning, he knew that his eyes were going to take him on a path of destruction. And what David does is much like what Achan does. He saw and he coveted and he took for himself, one of the great sins of David, a man after God's own heart. It's interesting that in all these cases, we know the power of what we see, the power of visual, of sight. In Matthew 18, Jesus is pretty serious about this when he says, if your eye causes you to sin, tear it out. throw it away. It's better for you to enter life with one eye than two eyes and be thrown into the fire of hell. Now, he's not saying you ought to physically rip out your eye, but he's saying this is how radical you ought to be in watching and guarding your eyes. You need to be careful about what you look at, about what you see. Our culture is a visual culture. You know, I was talking last week about the power of our words, and I used Martin Luther King Jr., Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., as an example of one of the great speeches. Have you ever thought about, we don't hear speeches anymore. You get sound bites is what you get. And you don't really get a whole lot of, you don't really get a lot of words, but you get a lot of visuals, and they're always coming at you from different directions. Now, again, like last week, I'm going to sound old, and I guess so, I am. But my dad, when he wanted to listen to a baseball game or watch a baseball game and he couldn't be there, he had to listen to it on the radio. And some of you know what I'm talking about. You had to get your radio out. You tuned it in. Y'all remember what a radio is? You tuned it in. You tuned it in to the baseball game, and you listened to the radio, and you listened to the baseball game. When I came along, they had something called a television. And it had tubes in it, and it was huge. Man, you did not want to help somebody move just because of their television. Now, man, you get a 60-foot television, and they're light, you know. My son's got televisions all over his house, and he's had me, like, he said, hey, Dad, I want you to come over. I want you to hold these up while I install them, you know. And I said, hey, let's get your mom to, you know, do some of that. And, so we go over, we can hold up his TV. That's easy to haul, these big old things. That's not anymore. Y'all, we had 13 channels. Do you remember that? 13 channels. And we flipped them, and then they went off at midnight. They played the national anthem, and total, it was just fuzz on the TV. You remember that? Just, well, static. Fuzz is what we called it. It got fuzzy. And it was time to go to bed. If you were up, by the way, when it went off, you were up too late. And not anymore. Hundreds and hundreds of channels. Our kids don't go into a room where the TV is. They take the TV with them wherever they go. They have an iPhone and an iPad that wherever they go, they can take this television. They don't have to be in a certain room, in a certain place. It's an amazing thing. Technology is an amazing thing, but it also is reminding us that our culture is a visual culture. It always has been, even more so. And I think with that, not only the multiplied channels, the multiplied opportunities there are for sexual content on the media is just absolutely multiplied. What we feed our eyes will eventually rule our hearts. And I'm not just talking about pornography. I'm talking about a myriad of other things in our life. Jesus said, the eye is the lamp of the body, so if your eye is healthy, your whole body will be full of light. Where your eye wanders, your heart will follow. Three things will be done. Number one is, make a covenant with your eyes. This is what Job said in Job 31 in verse 1. I've made a covenant with my eyes, Job said, not to look on a young virgin. I made a covenant with my eyes. Talking about individual freedom. I can't make this covenant for you. You got to make it for yourself, what you're going to look at. It's our responsibility to set a guard over our eyes. It's our responsibility to decide what we're going to take in. Decide now. And I think, you know, when children are young, we are going to decide for them. I think parents, they shouldn't give them an opportunity just to watch anything they want. They ought to monitor that and guard that and direct those in the right direction. You know, y'all, well-meaning, years ago, this congregation, many of us bought this. It was a tool that would cut out any bad word that was ever said on your television. And many of us, I'm one of those that bought it. But what it did is it cut out words that they thought were going to be bad. It cut out words that maybe were just kind of on, you know, they were not in euphemisms, but, you know, maybe it was an actual word donkey and they thought it was going to say something else, okay? And what it did was it cut out most of the show. It was just, you realize, man, how much trash is on the television, you know? And it was really an eye-opener kind of going through that, is that we shouldn't have a machine do that for us. We ought to be making those decisions ourselves. We can say, hey, listen, I don't want to see this. I'm going to walk away from this. I don't need to listen to this right now. And we can make a covenant with our eyes. Commit now, before the temptation comes, before it arrives, make up your mind that you are going to guard your eyes. You're going to guard what you're going to see. Psalm 119, the Bible says, turn my eyes from looking at worthless things and give me life in your ways. I think one of Job's ability to kind of control himself, you know, was connected with his covenant. He made a promise. There are some scholars that believe the covenant wasn't necessarily with his eyes. The covenant was with God. He was saying, hey, Lord, I'm promising you, help me to do better with the things I see, the things that I hear. And help me especially make this covenant with you, but it is against my eyes that I might look at the right kinds of things and turn away from those wrong things. Think over the centuries how that has changed, right? It's changed so much over the years. It's we have to be so careful about those things that we see. And y'all, God made us a certain way, okay? He made us. That especially men, that we are visual in what we see. A lot of things that you experience, I think a lot of young men kind of fight this battle. There's nothing wrong with you. God made you this way, and he made me this way. And I remember Larry coming to us one afternoon, and he said, I want permission to put a poster on the wall in my room. And I said, well, what poster is it? And it was a supermodel that was in a bikini that was, you know, oiled down. And I said, man, you know, I don't know. He goes, hey, listen, here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to put it on the back of my closet door. When people from the church come over, I'm going to close that door. They'll never know. They're never going to know it's there, you know. And I said, Larry, your mom's not going to let me have a poster like that. She's sure not going to let you have a poster like that. And but I got to tell y'all, I walked away from it saying, yeah, that is the battle that all of us fight, okay? I don't need to think that there's any man sitting in here that has overcome this struggle. We are all working on it, preacher included, and God made us a certain way with certain desires. But he also expects us to control it. And that's this next point, and it has to do with self-control. And that is, self-control is difficult, but it's not impossible. You can turn away. You can walk away. With the Spirit's help, with God's help in our life. That's what Romans 12 is. Romans 12, 1 and 2, right? Is that we're going to be a living sacrifice. We're going to lay ourselves on the altar. And this is one of the ways, self-control is actually one of the ways that we become a living sacrifice. Saying, Lord, I'm not going to be controlled by the world and my mind controlled by the world, but I'm going to be transformed by the renewing of my mind. I'm not going to be conformed by this world. And self-control is one of the ways we do that. Self-control is, it is difficult, but it is not impossible. You can overcome. You can walk away from certain temptations, and you can learn to put them, I believe, in their proper perspective. I taught on self-control this past Wednesday night, and the title of the lesson was The Power of Saying No, that there is power in saying no. I used stories from the Bible like Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego that were told they needed to bow down to a golden idol. They respectfully said, hey, guess what, King? We're not going to do that. It doesn't matter what you threaten us with. Doesn't matter what's coming, what you promise us. We're not going to do that. I believe there's great power in saying no. The more you say no, the stronger you're going to get. It's not going to go away, but I think all of us need to practice on saying no. I've been on a diet off and on now for 2 years. I've lost 3 pounds, And I guess give or take some. And y'all, one of the biggest struggles is the power of saying no. And what I've learned is not just, you know, you got to quit eating portions and certain things, and also having to walk, you know, and exercise and all those things. I have all kinds of excuses all kinds of excuses, why I shouldn't, why I can't. And so I've started walking again with Kay. I walk with Kay, and this is embarrassing to say, she walks so much faster than I do. I feel like a little kid, like running to keep up with her. My legs are long. I take long strides. I played basketball in college and high school. She can outwalk me, and she walks away. And sometimes she does this thing where she's waiting on me on the track, and she's walking around in circles. It's almost taunting me. I'm waiting on you, you know. Catch up, Tubby. And so here I come, man. I know. But y'all, I got to tell you, every time I do it, I feel stronger. Every time I walk away from a temptation, I feel stronger. And it's the same way with any kind of temptation in our life. It's difficult, but it is not impossible. And here's the last thing, and that is we need to live like God is watching and he's listening, because he is. You know, I think Job understood this. In Job 31, verse 1, he says, I've made a covenant with my eyes. But in Job 31, in verse 4, he says, does he not see all of my ways and count all of my steps? One of the things that encouraged Job, it wasn't discouraging, it wasn't threatening to Job, that God was watching him. He was looking at him. Proverbs 5 and verse 21, for a man's ways are before the eyes of the Lord, and he ponders all of his paths. Just to know that you're not alone, that God is there, he's watching. I love, this is Psalm 139, listen to it. Oh Lord, you have searched me and known me. When I sit down, you see me. The rising up, you have seen me. You discern my thoughts from afar. You search my path, my lying down. You're acquainted with all of my ways. Even before a word was on my tongue, behold, O Lord, you know it all together. You hem me in behind and before. You lay your hand on me. So he does see it when we do something wrong. But guess what? He also sees when we're in trouble. He sees when we're hurting. He sees when we're in despair and we're discouraged. When we have anxiety in our life, he sees and he cares. That's the whole point. Job is saying, I know you see my life, and I love the fact that you see my life. I need to make some changes, but you also see my life when I'm hurting. I told this story before, but years ago, I was doing a gospel meeting in South Georgia, and Kay couldn't come, and the kids were small, they were in school, and so I was in a hotel room by myself, and there was a lot kind of going on in the meeting. I was kind of going back and forth, and Kay called me one night, and I was kind of disappointed she couldn't come with me to the meeting, but I understood she had to stay here. It's kind of fun now, as our kids are grown, that we travel together and can do these gospel meetings together. And but she said, hey, what are you doing tonight? And I said, well, I'm sitting here on the bed of the hotel room, and I got my sermon out. I'm going over my sermon for tomorrow. And I'm just really sitting here just thinking, you know, about different things. And I said, well, what are you doing? And she said, I'm standing right outside your door. Could you open it up? And oh, man, what a great surprise, right? I was so glad to see her. And I was so glad I was doing exactly what I said I was doing. When she opened the door, my sermon was laid out. But I didn't run and lay it out real fast, you know. It was laid out and you know. And I think sometimes we think, you know, well, someone's got to come along with us and see it all. The Lord, he sees. And by the way, he's seen my mistakes. He's seen those things that are where I've disappointed him. And he also knows where I have gotten back up and I've tried again, and you can too. Our eyes matter. They matter to God, and they should matter to us. What we see really does matter, and we should guard our hearts by guarding our mouth and guarding our eyes. Jesus said, look at the birds of the air. They don't sow or reap, gather into barns, yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not more value than they? We're valuable. God has placed great value on our life. Guard that value. Where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. We're gonna sing this morning, Jesus paid it all. All to him I owe. He paid the greatest price for us, didn't he? That he came from heaven to earth in the form of a man, dying on a cross, overcoming sin and death so that we could do the same. What an incredible, wonderful thing for us to know that God loves us. He'll never stop loving us. He died for us. He sent his son to die for each and every one of us, that you might believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, willing to confess him, willing to repent, willing to turn away from that sin, willing to be baptized into Christ and raised to walk in a brand new life. God loves you today. He loves each and every one of you. He's not going to give up on you. Don't give up on yourself. You've fallen. You messed up. We all do. But I want to tell you, God, he does care about you. But there's something I want us to be serious about. I want us to be serious about guarding our eyes, guarding our mouth. Because in guarding those two things, we will guard, I think, one of the most precious things to all of us. We'll be guarding our hearts. It's out of the heart that a man speaks. It's out of a heart that moves him, that directs him. And so we need to protect, I think, the most important things, our heart. Save it for him. Give it to him. He will take it home. He will take it home with him one day. I'll be here at the front. Another elder will be with me. If we can help you in any way, you come while we stand and sing, "Jesus Paid It All." The Hardwick family wants us to pray for Amanda Hardwick. She's 40 years old, and she is having some medical issues. She needs to be strengthened in the Lord. And so they ask for those two things. And this is her sister who has come on behalf of Mom. And we, like Peter said, where else could we go? Only you have the words of eternal life. We'll take this to the one that can do something about it. Lord, we thank you for this avenue of prayer, that you're listening, that you care. We pray for Amanda, Lord, that you will bless her and strengthen her, help her physically, whatever's going on in her life, that you will help strengthen her, and not only physically but also spiritually. You'll strengthen her in the inner man, that as the days move forward, that she'll see strength coming from you, that she'll feel your presence like never before, that she'll lean on you and trust you, that she'll be a student of your word, that she'll talk to you about her life. We pray, Lord, for her family. We thank you that they love her so much that they would bring her name before us this morning. And as we lift it to you, we know you know exactly what to do. And we thank you already in advance for doing it. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
We saw thee not when thou didst come to this world of sin and death, nor yet beheld thy parents home in thy disguise and mask of death. But we did believe thy host has taught its streets and
morning. It is now time for us to prepare our minds for the Lord's Supper. If you are like me, then your week, maybe some of your days, maybe this morning, was filled with much that kept you busy and occupied. If you are like me, then throughout those events, you might have prioritized one thing over another. And if you are like me, then you might have had a list of things to do and still forgotten to do some of those things. We as humans are a busy people, and we are forgetful people. This morning, we have come to this gathering in the midst of all the busy that is going on and in our lives, in the midst of all those distractions that take our attentions elsewhere. And we have made it a priority, and what an encouragement that is. So as we pause for a moment, let us remember Christ's sacrifice this morning as we gather around the table. Let us consider his broken body and his spilt blood, and let us never forget that he bore the cross for you and me. Let's pray for the cup, or for the bread. Lord, we thank you for your sacrifice, and sometimes it's hard to imagine everything that took place, but we know you did it out of love for us. As we partake of this bread this morning, I pray that we do so in a way that honors you. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Continue our prayer for the cup. Lord, we thank you for enduring such agony so that we might have hope eternal. We thank you for bearing our sins on the cross and shedding your blood to do so. Bless this cup as we partake. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. That concludes Lord's Supper. At this time, we will take up a collection for the work of the church here. I know we've all been blessed in so many ways, so let's give thanks for all those blessings. Lord, we thank you for all the blessings in our lives, and we thank you for all the gifts that each of us has. Lord, I pray that we are good stewards of the things that you put into our possessions, that we might use them for your glory. We know that you have the ability to multiply all our gifts, and we ask that you all these gifts honor you. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
We are grateful for your presence today, everyone here in the auditorium, everyone that is joining us online as well. If you are visiting, give us an opportunity to meet you at the end of the service. And now, if it is convenient, would you stand for the closing song?
Be not dismayed, for there be time. God will take care of you. Beneath his wings above abide. God will through every day or all the way.
Heavenly Father, we come to you with bowed heads this morning, thanking you, Lord, for the opportunity to see this day, the opportunity to be in your presence at this time during this worship, whether it's in the auditorium or online. Heavenly Father, I pray this morning that everyone in this worship has invested in this worship service this morning. And as we heard this morning, Lord, it is what we give and put in as to what we're going to receive out of it. We pray, Heavenly Father, that we guard our eyes, we guard our minds, and we're always mindful that you are there with us and watching. But Heavenly Father, let us do the things that are right and pleasing to you, because it is the right thing to do, and it is what you expect from us as Christians. Heavenly Father, as we know, it's not a matter of if, but when Satan is going to tempt us. But it is in those times, Lord, that we pray that we keep our eyes stayed on you, and that you will bring us through on the other side. Heavenly Father, as we conclude this worship service, please be with us. Keep us safe until the next appointed time that we come together. These and all blessings we ask in thy Son, Jesus' name. Amen.
It's me again. Just a quick reminder, we're starting a new class. It's called the Hill Climbers, and that will be starting next week. And I think we're going to be in room 101. But this is a class that is designed for the ages of 40-ish and under. But these life stages might include the career builders. These are those entering and pursuing careers. You might be a home builder. Those might be newly married, young married, and those starting and nurturing families. The relationship and life builders, those pursuing meaningful friendships and Christ-like fellowship, those looking to be connected and encouraged. So if you think you might fall into one of these life stages, this group is for you. We would love to start connecting with you, but if not, we will see you next week.
Thank you, Curtis. We love Curtis and Danielle. I'm so glad he's going to be teaching that class, helping with that class. Appreciate him so much. We're going to have the class in here for 40-ish and up. And we're going to be talking about prayer and the power of prayer in our life. If you want to work on your prayer life, that's what these classes in the auditorium will be the coming quarter. On Wednesday night, we're going to be talking about living like Jesus and specific lessons about what it means to live the life of Jesus. Two great quarter classes, but I'm really excited about our Hill Climbers. And I love, by the way, well, I guess that it's gone, but the what you had up here, yeah, no, yeah. So the graphic of our, you see the S for Snellville, you know, and Snellville Hill Climbers, that graphic, I think Josh did that for us. Josh is a multi-talented person, and but I was thinking we could do one for like the 40s and over, us like falling down like a mountain, you know, and could you work on that, you know, Josh, us, or help us helping each other up for different reasons. Anyway, we knelt down and couldn't get up. So, speaking of youth, our young people are going to have a retreat March 15th through the 17th, and it's at North Georgia Christian Camp. It's second grade through 12th grade. It's really a cool thing because the older kids in the youth group will teach our younger kids, and they put together activities. And it's just a great, the cost is only $50. If you can't meet that cost, I'm sure there's scholarship money to help you do that. Registration is today. Please see either Candace, I know who's pretty busy today, but Josh especially. And today is our widow and widower's luncheon. And every year we try to honor those in our congregation that are widows or widowers. And you might be visiting here this morning and find yourself in that category. We'd love for you to be a part of that luncheon. We have enough food. It's being catered by Olive Garden. It's delicious. And so we really would love to have you. And I want to thank Candace. This is one of the things Candace says, hey, I want to involve the young people in serving our widow and widowers. And so for Melinda and Candace and all those that have a part in putting on that luncheon today, man, we appreciate you so much. Carol Morris's dad, Tom Ware, who is in mid-90s, fell, and now he's been in the hospital. He's got brain issues and fluid on his brain, and they've drained it, and they're doing some other things. Obviously, he's frail. One of the best men I've ever known in my life. I've known him for as long as Kay and I have been dating, and he was an elder at the church in North Georgia. And Carol, I know you love him as a dad, but he's a wonderful man. Please pray for Tom. Jimmy Joins is across the street in rehab. He's in room E18. I'm sure he would appreciate your visit. He's going to dialysis 3 times a week. So if you happen to drop by and he's not there, that's where he is. Bobby Knight's recovering from surgery, and he's in physical therapy now. Pray for Bobby. Mary Jo Killingsworth started chemo. This is Christy Romine's sister. Donna Brown got the staples out from her surgery, but does have an infection, but she's hoping to travel back to Georgia after her serious surgery. And then Debbie Davis's sister-in-law, Janie Harvey, is recovering from major cancer surgery. Pray for Perry and Suzette. They are in Nigeria now, working on Right Steps, right? And Moises is on the board of Right Steps. We help Right Steps as a congregation, one of the great mission works. Glad to be a part of it, but they're over there now. A lot of people have asked about Jim Dobbs. Is there going to be a service? Are you going to have a service for Jim? And I don't know the answer to that. Jim told his family he didn't want to make a fuss. He didn't want us to come over and sing to him last week, but I got a bunch of people. We went over to his house, and he went on to heaven before we got there. That's just how much he didn't want us to make a fuss. It was almost like, I'll show you, but you know what? We sang anyway. And it really, I don't regret it, because it turned out that a group of people standing in the yard were singing praises, and his family was inside, and his daughter, his grandson, Mike, and Helen, of course, and they heard those praises, and we had prayer together, and we were able to go in and encourage them. So it ended up being a minute. When does it ever happen that someone passes away in this congregation and there's more than 100 people in their front yard? And it's almost like God intended for us to be there for him during that time. And so we did what we do. We loved on him, and then they took care of things. If there is a service, and I hope there is, we'll let you know. I told Ann we'll follow her lead. It's up to her. You live 100 years, and you lived as storied a life as Jim. It's certainly worth reflecting on. But y'all, he's preached his funeral all of his life. He's been a preacher for a long time. Did you know Jim was an actor at one time? He was a part of the Actors Guild. He was part of the Mensa program. So smart. And one of the most wonderful, encouraging people we've ever known here in this congregation. And so pray for Helen and all of them. And again, I want to tell you, we're going to go next door, have a little luncheon. If you're a widow, widower, I hope you'll come be a part of it. The kids are going to serve you. They're going to be encouraging. They're going to sit by you and say things like, why are you so wrinkly? And things like that. So just want to prepare you. Not all of them is going to be encouraging. But you'll get a story to tell, I promise you. And you'll have a good meal. We'll have a good time together because we love you. Let's pray together. Father, thank you today for loving us. We thank you for the blessing of being able to be together today. We take for granted just the ability that we have to hear and to see and to interact with one another. It's only until something is taken away from us that we truly appreciate what we've had. And it's such a shame that it has to be taken away from us. before we appreciate it. And so help us, Lord, to be good stewards of all that you've given us, including our ears and our eyes, our heart, and in all of our life. We ask that you bless every soul present, every soul that joined us online, and help us, Lord, to serve you every day, to be a light in a dark world, to be salt to those around us, to be a voice of encouragement leading people toward you and not certainly away from you. Help us, Lord, to know that that you provided a home that we'll be in one day. And oh, how great it's going to be to see Jim Dobbs again. How wonderful it's going to be to see my mom and those who have gone on before us. But it'll pale in comparison to be able to get to see you face to face, to be able to say thank you for making a way where there was no way, helping us through this life like you have every day, every moment. We so are grateful for all of this, and we lift this to you. Help us, Lord, to keep sowing the good seed, to know that we don't want to grow weary, don't ever give up, and because we know in due time, in due season, we will reap what is coming. Thank you, Lord, for that blessing. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.